most prolific female studio director in American film history, Dorothy Arzner had a film career that lasted from 1919 to 1943, 15 of those years as a director. She was the only woman director during the golden age of Hollywood's studio system. Feminist film critics and queer theorists who are interested in this pioneering filmmaker's body of work, as well as the critical possibilities presented by feminist approaches to understanding that work as a whole, have given her substantial scholarly attention. She began typing scripts for the famous Players Lasky Corporation, which would later become Paramount, and thus began her career in the film industry. After 6 months, she moved on to Real Art Studio, a Paramount subsidiary, where she worked as a cutter and an editor, before being invited back to Paramount to cut and edit the Valentino vehicle Blood and Sand, 1922, her first big picture, and the first movie for which she had participated in parts of the filming. She served as chief editor for 52 films. She made history by becoming the first female director of a sound film with Manhattan Cocktail, 1928. Arzner joined the Directors Guild of America as the organization's first female member in 1933. She was, in fact, the DGA's lone female member for a very long time. On the set of The Wild Party, 1929, Arzner, who was frustrated that the microphone was constantly in the same spot, ordered the sound crew to attach it to a fishing pole and have it follow the actors around the set, effectively inventing the boom microphone. Dance Girl Dance, 1940, is the only movie she directed that the Library of Congress determined to be culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant and added to the National Film Registry. Many of Arzner's films contain themes of unconventional romance and turned conventional societal views of women upside down. A running theme in Arzner's work is the repressiveness of heterosexual marriage. Arzner, a lesbian, cultivated a masculine image with both her attire and her demeanor. Many queer critics find that some of her films have a subtext that is gay. She was also engaged in depicting female interactions. Many have observed how strongly Arzner's sound works, including The Wild Party in 1929, Working Girls in 1931, and Dance Girl Dance in 1940, focus on women's relationships with one another. Both feminist film critics and queer film theorists have embraced Arzner because they see in her atypical characters a subversiveness that this theory connects with her lesbianism. Lesbian critics find a critique of heterosexuality as the root of a woman's problems in the film Christopher Strong, in contrast to feminist critics who see a critique of gender inequality. Theorists have noted that in the film, the idea that heterosexual monogamy cripples the imagination and curbs the appetite for living is present. By depicting a sincere moment of connection between Cynthia and Elaine in Christopher Strong, Arzner complicates and questions conventional conceptions of women rather than pitting the two women against one another and buying into the narrative of women as rivals. Arzner's telling of Craig's wife turned the story into a plea for women to become their own people, rather than beautiful possessions. In Craig's wife, Arzner offers the possibility of a woman's community after the instability of heterosexual romance with the final scene between Harriet and her widowed next-door neighbor. Both women have been left by their husbands in vastly different ways, and their next potentially meaningful connection is with each other. The film Dance Girl Dance is one of Arzner's most well-known works. It is another illustration of how Arzner challenged and complicated conventional representations of women and female relationships. The movie is Arzner's most celebrated and extensively researched piece, and it tackles themes such as social mobility, female relationships, and female performance. But what stands out most is how the movie challenges the male gaze. Dance Girl Dance foregrounds dance as women's channel for economic independence and self-expression. Maureen O'Hara's character Judy stops her stage performance in a moment towards the end of the film to speak directly to the diegetic male audience in a powerful rebuke of the men's objectification of women. Judy confronts them, This moment has been interpreted in feminist film studies as a returning of the male gaze and a greater address to the real-life audience, not simply the diegetic audience. Arzner's uneven collection of work generated debate because it concentrated on feminist themes that anticipated those of modern filmmakers, including Lizzie Borden, Joyce Chopra, and Agnes Varda. After completing First Comes Courage in 1943, Arzner left the entertainment industry. Although the reason for Arzner's retirement is unknown, it is assumed that a decline in the critical and financial successes of her films was the cause. It might also have been brought on by the rise in systematic homophobia and sexism following the passage of the Hays Code. Even after leaving Hollywood, Arzner kept up her work in the field of film. During World War II, she produced training videos for the Women's Army Corps.
And stare. I'm not ashamed. Go on, laugh, get your money's worth. Nobody's going to hurt you. I know you want me to tear my clothes off so as you can look your 50 cents worth. 50 cents for the privilege of staring at a girl the way your wives won't let you. What do you suppose we think of you up here? With your silly smirks, your mothers would be ashamed of. And we know it's the thing of the moment for the dress suits to come and laugh at us, too. We'd laugh right back at the lot of you, only we're paid to let you sit there and roll your eyes and make your screamingly clever remarks. What's it for? So as you can go home when the show's over and strut before your wives and sweethearts and play at being the stronger sex for a minute? I'm sure they see through you just like we do.